Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us here on Gov's Comedy Club podcast. Welcome to another Q&A with the one and only Elio Pace. And as a surprise special guest sitting right next to him, no, not Michael McDonald, but the one and only Neil Fairclough, ladies and gentlemen. What a nice surprise that is. Welcome, guys. How you doing?
Hello, Tony. Hello. It's good to see you, mate.
Good to see you guys. How's everybody doing? All right?
Yeah, we're good. You know, Neil, we're starting rehearsals tomorrow. And
what? Neil's a day early?
He's down. And I said, listen, I'm going live with Tony tonight. Come and say hello. So this is why Neil's here.
Good to see you, Tony.
Good to see you, Neil. Neil Fairclough, bassist for Queen with Adam Lambert, bassist and singer with the Deccan Traps. I love the Deccan Traps, pal. I love the stuff you guys have put out so far.
Oh, thanks very much. It's very kind. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, we're aiming to get a whole album out, but as you know, it's been pretty difficult with the pandemic, and yet at the same time, it's been a good time to try and get stuff out. But we've just had to, basically, it's things like money and time and getting everyone together at the same time. But so we're hoping later on this year,
right,
we should have something.
Nice.
I'm saying that knowing that, this time next year, I'll be saying, this time, definitely this time.
I tell you what, though, isn't that stuff worth waiting for? Doesn't it sound amazing?
Oh, absolutely.
The Great Divide, I think, should go down as one of the sort of modern rock classics. I think it's fantastic. And what people don't realize, sorry, he's too modest to tell you, is that Neil is a co-writer of all this stuff. He's not just the bass player in the band. It's his project, and he's one of three co-writers. Isn't that right?
Yeah, John and Lois, my sister Lois and her husband, John.
Oh, wow.
We've known each other a long time. We can work that out, can't we? But the rest of the guys in the band, apart from Ricardo, the singer, we've known each other since we were in our late teens. This is what's really nice about this. We've sort of coalesced back together and we're doing this. It started out as something different, but we decided to do it ourselves. And then Ricardo, who we all loved, got on board as well. So
what a singer he is.
Exciting, yeah.
Well,
it's a brilliant band.
That's what I was going to ask. I mean, where in the world did you find him? I mean, and why is that man not already famous? I mean, the voice on that guy, it's like, it's like listening to 1970s David Coverdale or something.
He love you that you said that. He's one of his idols. Well, he's one of all of our idols.
I knew that, which is why I threw that in, by the way. I do my research.
Oh, fantastic. Well, thank you. We knew of him because we'd seen him around and obviously the We Will Rock You stuff that he did back in, I think it was 2008, something like that.
So he was in the musical We Will Rock.
Yeah, he was Galileo.
Okay. I didn't know that. Okay.
He'd done stuff before that. He played in bands and stuff, but did that for, and I think then he just did a lot of different things. We saw him on TV just doing various things. Obviously he's Portuguese, so the stuff that he'd done over there as well. And I thought, I'll speak to a mutual friend of ours and I'll ask him, do you think he'll mind if I get in touch, And he said, yeah, no, give him a call. And so we agreed to meet in a pub somewhere down in London. I can't remember what the pub's called now. And it was straight away. We were all on the same wavelength, he loved it. We loved him. And but there's, on top of that, there's an interesting story to do with what we had to, what we're up against up until now. That's probably another story,
right.
But
just push Elio out of the way. It's a Deccan Traps hour.
No, I'm happy to listen to this. This is fantastic. Yeah. You should have Neil on.
Maybe we'll do something.
Would love to. I've asked you before, haven't I? I would love to do something with Neil.
Yes, you have. I'm so sorry. I can't remember what excuse.
Nothing to apologize for.
But it was amazing, though.
It was a very good excuse.
I think I was helping NASA, if I remember
yes,
rightly.
Was it.
No, we will do, Tony, yes, now that we've got stuff on the boil, on the go. Is that a saying?
Yeah, it is now.
It is now. On the boil.
On the boil, not yeah.
I mean, my ass is burning.
So there we go. And then we've got this amazing tour, albums tour that we've got to talk about in some detail. Yes.
Yeah. Starting, so the first show is when? This Friday?
Friday, in my hometown of Eastleigh, where I was born. Well, not born, I was born in Woking in Surrey, but when I was 3 years old, we moved down to the south coast of England, and then we settled in Eastleigh. I've been there since, I don't know, since I was about 8 years old, 9 years old or something.
Very nice.
So it's fantastic. I love playing in Eastleigh. But yeah, it's a 10-date tour, and looking forward to it. These little exclusive boutique little tours of all this rare Billy Joel stuff, which you will never get to hear again after we finish the tour. You know,
that is true.
I love talking to you about it, Tony, because I know how much you're into all this stuff. So,
well, thank you, pal, and likewise. You know how much I love everything you guys do, and love talking to you, and love all the support as well. I'm going to get right into the questions. Got a bunch of them.
Okay.
Going to say hi to where. So, if you guys are watching, you can submit some questions. We're watching on the YouTube feed. So that's the Gov's Comedy Club podcast. That's the name of the YouTube channel. If you want to go there and comment, and I'm going to do my best to read the comment, some of the comments as they come in. If you have a question, so a lot of you have submitted questions in advance, which I'm going to get to. So I'll be keeping an eye on the comments on the YouTube feed as well. And that is where Sally is watching, and Emma Lumley, who gave me, I don't know, like 800 questions. Our pal Carl Wooden is watching. Andy Green says hello. Okay. But the first question,
hi to everybody.
Hello.
Yeah. The first question I'm going to play is not one of mine. And forgive me for doing it kind of prehistorically. I'm just going to hold my phone up because I just got this about an hour ago, and I just didn't have time to set it all up on the computer here. So
okay.
So bear with me. All right. Let's see. Whoops.
Me, Marcello.
Can you hear it? Yes. Okay.
I would like ask, are you going to miss having David Brown on the tour? And are you excited about doing the show?
All right, so for those of you who didn't get that,
Tony, that voice sounds familiar.
It might sound familiar to some of you, maybe. That was a very good radio personality and journalist and interviewer, Marcella Pace, asking if David Brown will be on the tour and how excited Elio is about the tour.
Well, hello, Marcella, and thank you for your question.
First time, long time, as a matter of fact.
It's the first what? Sorry?
That's an expression we have here in America. When people call into radio shows, they'll say first time, long time, as in first time caller, but a long time listener. You guys don't have that there?
First time, long time. No, never heard that.
Oh, okay. No. Yeah, that's an expression here. So that's what that was the joke that just kind of failed. I said that was Marcella, first time, long time.
Oh, well, hello, Marcella. Thank you for that. And I love you. And, well, you know that we were all excited about seeing David Brown. David Brown is just one of the most phenomenal guitar players in the world. And what he did with Billy Joel was fantastic. What he did with Simon and Garfunkel was fantastic. What he did with Paul McCartney and Dr. John and Julian Lennon. He's just phenomenal. And I loved David Brown from the beginning when I saw him for the first time with Billy in 1990 on the Stormfront tour at Wembley Arena. I sat at the back of the room and I loved the gig. And I remember thinking how great everything sounded. It was brilliant. And I grew to love David's playing. Then when we came up with the ideas of starting to do the album shows, I had the idea of asking David if he would like to be involved. Now, David had contacted me previously to say some nice things about what he'd seen on social media. And so I thought, well, if we're going to be friends, David, how about you come over and let's play? And I couldn't believe it when he said yes. And so he came over and he did the first album show tour. Street, Innocent Man and Glass Houses, 2018. And then in 2019, just before the pandemic, we did Stormfront and The Stranger. And it was fantastic. We had it down. We were going to do one in 2020. Well, of course, the pandemic saw good to that. And that was it. So David, unfortunately, is not going to be part of any more album shows. Really?
None.
He's not good.
Oh, that's a shame.
We had a wonderful conversation about 5 or 6 days ago because we have to make a decision about going forwards with this. And at this moment, David is just not confident about flying again after he had a little bout of COVID. I don't think he was very ill with it, but he certainly got caught on holiday with COVID and had to isolate on his own in the Dominican Republic. The rest of his family had went home and he was there on his own. And, wow. And you know, as it would do, it would knock your confidence if all of a sudden getting home was not easy. And I just think the thought of getting on a plane and coming to England, and what if he catches it again? Is he going to have to isolate again? So I'm just being really honest with everybody. But we spoke to David and I said, David, we just, you know, can you commit? And he said, I just don't want to let you down again. I said, okay, well, I'll tell you what we'll do. I said, we'll go ahead. We'll do the shows without you. We're starting this third tour. We've got three more tours to do, and we will have done all of Billy Joel's 12 studio albums. And just as a little nugget I'd like to throw in here, we are going to be doing another albums tour this year, folks. So there's another one coming up towards the end of the year. Those smart ones amongst them, I've had already some messages going, there's a big gap between your last Billy Joel Songbook show and the next one. There's like a 3-week gap. Is there something happening? Yes, there is something happening. And we'll announce all that closer to the time. But the theatres need to know. The posters need to be printed. Everything needs to be done. And unfortunately, David is just not in a position to say yes. So for the foreseeable future, for the remaining three tours, we're going to be advertising the show without David. Now, if David decides he wants to come at the 12th hour, he can come. He will always be welcome. We love him. And David, if you're watching or listening, if that ever happens, you know you'll be welcome. And and we'll just make it up as we go along. So that's what we're going to do.
We love you, David.
We love you, David.
As a big fan of Billy Joel and you know, and of course you guys, a lot of our conversations are based on just me being a fan, you know, apart from our friendship. So I'm just going to throw out there, I've seen other bands do this. Get David to play an acoustic guitar on video for one song and play. You guys just play to it at the show. Something interesting. Just maybe get a little message from him. Hi, everybody. You know, sorry, I'm not here. Whatever. Get him to play one song.
The only problem with that. The only problem.
No problem with that. Just do it.
I tell you what it is. It's a financial thing. A financial thing to bring a screen. To pack a screen, you know, we're not Queen, right?
He's so playing with Queen. He can fit the bill. Foot the bill for that.
Could you ask Brian? Talk to Brian. Yeah. No, I no. It's a lovely idea, but to have a screen and carry it and tour it and have all that other stuff going on, which is a visual thing, costs money. And you know, we're not there yet. We're not there quite yet. So. But I know what you mean. I know what you mean. Maybe we can think of something along those lines.
All right. So with that said, and yeah, that's sad. That is sad that David won't be there, but it's still going to be a fantastic show. It always is.
I've got an amazing band.
Right. That's exactly where I was going. Thanks.
And you know what? David said in his message to me, he said, Elio, with your boys, you're never going to fail. You've got a killer band. I mean, David absolutely loves the guys from Neil. Let me talk about Johnny Hayes, because Johnny Hayes is in the Deccan Traps. And in fact, was Neil's friend before he was even a guitar player in my band, you know. So Neil can tell you about Johnny Hayes, but Johnny is a phenomenal guitar player, right?
Consummate professional.
Yeah, he is.
He told me to say that. I've got it written down in my hand.
Next to £20, right?
Yes. Yeah, I think it's really exciting because the group of us, we just want to do a great job with these tracks. And
yeah,
well, everyone we've had in the band have been brilliant. But Johnny's you know, he just nails everything, and he does his homework, and he's not a sort of that'll do sort of thing. He goes above and beyond.
And what's also interesting is that without David Brown, that Johnny is going to be the first guitar player we've had in the album.
That's
show.
That's right. Yeah.
So there's a lot of, you know, he's got big shoes to fill, you know, but if anybody can do it, I mean, we're also blessed with Tom Wright as well.
Tom Wright is
lucky to have Tom. We've had Keith Atack, who's a legend as well, play guitar for us. I'm blessed with great players. We've got Mikey Chancho on drums, brilliant young drummer. We've got Matt Newton, who's a phenomenal keyboard player, and has the stuff that he's had to prepare for these two albums.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of keyboards, secondary keyboards, Moogs and strings and marimbas and vibes and all sorts. He's phenomenal. And then, of course, on the saxophone, we have the great Frank Walden. And anybody that knows the Street Life Serenade album and 52nd Street will go, well, there's not that much sax. Well, with musicians like Frank, who can play keyboards, who's a fantastic percussionist, sings, honestly. And David recognized that. David recognized that. He said, Elio, listen, as much as I am gutted I can't be there, I know the tour is going to be successful. We fingers crossed that it is, that nothing goes wrong. But, you know, we hope to. Can I just say that, by the way, in case we didn't mention it, Marcella is my lovely little daughter, soon to be 13 years old this year. So she's probably going to go off to bed now. But I loved her question. Good question, Marcella.
That's fantastic. all right, so yeah, great band. And I wanted to ask you, so how do you choose which albums you're gonna do each time?
That's a good question, mate.
Thank you.
That's a very good question. Well, when David said yes, I went, right, okay, so what are the two most incredible albums that he played with? And this is the first albums tour, so I've got to come out, come out with an awesome selection. So I chose Glass Houses and An Innocent Man. Innocent Man because it's got the biggest hits that Billy ever had on it, and Glass Houses because it was written for David Brown in a way. All that guitar rock and roll.
Yeah, very guitar oriented album.
Very
guitar
oriented. So I thought these are the great two albums to kick off with. In hindsight, had I known that this was going to end up being, we're going to do all 12, I wouldn't have paired Glass Houses with An Innocent Man, because it's like two killer albums, you know, two like of the biggest albums. You see, you know, you need to keep your powder dry slightly, don't you? So so then after we did that and we realized that I got the bug for it, and I was like, I am going to have to do every one of these albums, and all these poor guys in the band. Neil was like, really? I mean, I'm sure there's a chance. He probably wants to say no. Do we have to do all 12? But we're going to do it. So then I just sat down, and then I looked at the set list or the running order of the albums and went, well, which song would close the first half well? Which one would close the show well?
Yeah, because the thing to remember is that it doesn't necessarily hold that the last track of an album is necessarily a show closer, you know?
Right, right.
Well, I'm sure in the case of 52nd Street, which we're just about to do, right, 52nd Street, the song, nobody would normally close with a song called that. But Until the Night comes just before it, you know? So, yeah.
I'm sure for a live setting, yeah, you know, with the same songs, I'm sure the running order would be totally different, you know, energy-wise, show-wise, you know.
So, but it's a very different vibe, Tony, because you know, imagine when we come to, well, Uptown Girl, for instance, Uptown Girl was in the middle of the second half.
Right, right. Where normally it would be an encore or close to the end. Right.
When we did Glass Houses, the first song is You May Be Right, which we use as an encore in the Songbook show.
Right.
You know, when we come to do the Piano Man album, Piano Man will be second song in. I'm not going to tell you whether it's the first or the second half, but it'll be the second song in on one of the halves. I mean,
the thing to remember is that the audiences, they get it, don't they?
Yeah.
They know this isn't the normal show, and that, you know, that they're coming to see these albums. We have a thing, or at least I have a thing, where it's, I say to Elio, you realise with Billy that there aren't any wasted bars, you know what I mean? Or at least he's not just hanging around waiting for an hour, you know what I mean? Everything's written with purpose, you know, and design. It's going somewhere, you know. And it's pretty rare, that, isn't it?
I love the fact that you said that. Neil did say that once. He said, the thing about Billy Joel is that there are no wasted bars. Now, there are some great, honestly, as we all know, amazing other bands and songwriters and things. But there are little moments where you go, oh, okay, they're grooving on that. They've gone round it four times. And then they've gone round it again. And they just added a little dip, 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 second time round. Wasted bars, in a way. I mean, it's, you know, if you want to dance, it's different. But
right.
But Billy doesn't write wasted bars. The best I could find as far as, did he really need to do all that in Until the Night, when it breaks down to the... and he plays it first and then he hums it and then he sings it. But even that's not wasted.
Well, because it's taking you on a journey. You know, yeah. I think that's... It's a bit of a shame, really. Not that we won't get into it, but I think...
no, let's get into it.
Yeah. I think what's missing with today with a lot of music is... And it's not because it's not there. There's a lot of amazing music out there. It's just that it doesn't really get pushed. Is that I think we've lost that... you know, when you're taking on a journey, you know, you're set up for a section that's coming and then the emotional payoff, you know.
Yeah.
Whereas, and it's always been the case, but, you know, we've got to get to the chorus quickly or let's do it. But, you know, it's just not around anymore, at least comparatively anyway.
Yeah. We talk about that a lot here. We're streaming from a comedy club, and we talk about that a lot because we talk to the comedians about how, you know, in the old days, you know, we used to just hang flyers somewhere. Now it's social media and it's TikTok. And for us older folks, the TikTok is just so hard because there's no originality, there's no quality content. It's just some random 30-second thing, silly thing to make somebody laugh real quick that you don't need a lot of thought and originality for. And I think that kind of falls in line with what you're saying, that, you know, a lot of, because they got to get to the chorus so fast, you don't get, you know, some good stuff within the tune.
We are a changed society.
Yeah,
we are
absolutely
a changed society. And art, in a way, I suppose, reflects, art has always reflected society. And I suppose the modern art of our era does that as well, which why it's, you know, it's very simple. It's not very convoluted, yeah. Very, very plain, simple chords. I mean, rock and roll was only three chords, but, you know, there was something else going on with rock and roll and rhythm and blues.
Passion and character.
And yeah, and character and real instruments playing and, you know, music being played by, oh, here's a good idea, musicians, you know.
I mean, it is worth mentioning that, you know, there are amazingly talented young musicians.
We were talking about Bruno Mars earlier on.
Anderson Paak. Wow. Other musicians who may be more in the jazz and funk and stuff, you know, they're amazing, you know.
There's some brilliant musicians.
You have to sort of search it out, you know. The example I give, I don't know if it's that true in America, because you've always had charts, haven't you, with particular things. Well, in Britain in the past.
Different genres for different charts.
Different genres, different charts, different genres, but... but you did have like a top 40, didn't you?
Oh yeah,
it's the Billboard 100, right? Yeah, it's the main top 40, top.
Yeah, yeah, so but it's broken up into categories: adult, contemporary, rhythm and blues, rock, whatever. Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Well, in Britain, it's sort of in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. You would get, you know, in five or six chart places, you'd get sort of like, you know, like a pop. Like Culture Club next to Neil Diamond, next to
Shaking Stevens,
next to, you know, Iron Maiden,
yeah,
next to Al Jarreau. So anyone who is watching, they're already exposed to five, six, seven different genres, or at certain styles at least, you know, and you know, there could be reggae, Latin, you know, within the same amount of chart positions.
Yeah.
And it's a shame we don't have that anymore because you know, I think you're missing a treat. You know what I mean? You have to now, don't get me wrong, there's so much out there that is brilliant.
But you have to go find it.
Yeah.
Because it's not popular culture.
Yeah, because people don't necessarily know if they're going to like it. Whereas if you just introduce something to them, they might go, oh, what's this? This is amazing. You
know? That's right. That's right.
So, yeah. So it's a shame, really. But
yeah. I want to touch upon something you were talking about a few minutes ago regarding doing an album show. Is it... is it harder from a performance standpoint? You know, because you're doing a regular concert, and you know you're building an energy, and you know you have the, you know, whether it's you or anybody, you have the performer, you know, and the energy, and then the energy kind of builds and goes with whatever songs are being played, and
absolutely,
and then you know you play like a slow number, and you know. And then you come up with a fast tune, and that gets you in, you know, the energy going, because they didn't know what was coming. So Is it tricky to do an albums tour because the audience knows what song is coming next? Is there anything you have to do differently from a performance standpoint?
That's a very good question, and this is why the Songbook show, myself and Matt Daniel Baker, we sat for hours going through every single Billy Joel song. And we put them in categories: slow songs, fast songs, story songs, biographical songs, hits, non-hits, album. We did all that, and then we crafted what we believed, and we, bar one change in 2014, after the very first show we ever did, bar one change, that set list basically has never changed, the structure of it. We're always going to start with the same three songs. Is always good, because crafting a set list is important.
No, oh, yeah.
West End musical theatre people know this. You know, any artist knows it. What I absolutely love about the album show is that the game's given away. Everybody, you buy the album, you know what we're going to play. Right. You know that people are saying, "Wow, he's going to finish the first half on Friday with the Mexican Connection." Dum 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 dum. Right,
it was a wonderful duet.
You would never program. Sorry, Tony, what are you going to say?
I said that was a wonderful duet. I said that's all.
Thank you. You'd never program it, but what I love is that the people that are coming to see the album shows are coming knowing that this is not going to be an all singing and all dancing, beautifully scripted. It is so laid back, it's so relaxed, and we just let the albums play themselves. We sort of, you know, respecting the fact that whoever programmed the album, we're going to respect them, we're going to do the songs in the album order, and I think that's one of the beauties of why the show has been so successful, because it is so differently written, naturally written, than any other show that you would normally go to, which would save all your best hits till the end and come on and see you get up and dance. Well, there's none of that. There is none of that at all. It becomes about the music, becomes about the skill of the people on stage, and it becomes about the genius of Billy's writing and the beautiful albums. This has never been done with Billy's albums. I still can't quite believe it, but yeah. So I, that's why I personally love playing these album shows, because it's almost so laid back, it's so relaxed.
Paul Wallace he's watching, so I may as well read his question.
Paul.
Paul Watson, he says, you get to make an album of your own material. You can choose any producer you want. Who would you pick?
Do you know who I would have said, and probably if I had a chance now, you've got to answer this question as well.
Have I? Okay.
Do you know who I would have absolutely adored to be in a studio with, guiding me through my own material? You're never going to believe this. Benny Anderson from ABBA.
I don't believe you.
I think that man is a genius. Those ABBA records, which I've been listening to a lot in the last few months, because ABBA releasing a brand new album just blows my mind.
Yeah.
ABBA, you know, the whole hologram gig, which I'm definitely going to go and see. You know, I know it's expensive, but I'm saving up my pennies. Benny Anderson, I know Bjorn Ulvaeus was also a genius, but Benny Anderson's the musician, real musician behind all those hits.
That's the keyboard player, right?
He's the keyboard player.
Yeah, yeah.
He's okay. The guy that was... But he wrote all the arrangements. He was there at every production, meeting and production session, at the mixing. Those are his incredible, incredible, beautiful songs. And I just love he released some of his own solo stuff as well. And I thought that was brilliant. The Benny Anderson Band. Oh, wow. I just think that I would really, really love to hear what comes out of his head when he heard my melodies. And now, if I was doing a funk album or a rock and roll album, maybe not. But there's a whole other Latin melodic side to my adoration of music. And some of the music that I've stored up and still have not released or recorded is very, very melodic, very almost Abba-esque. It is Billy Joel meets Abba. And so, yeah, the first person, Paul, that comes to my mind would be Benny Anderson, because I've thought about it many times in the last 30-odd years. Neil?
Well, I hadn't thought about it, so I'm sort of halfway stumped here. I think, I guess I always liked Ted Templeman. Did he do
Michael Jackson?
Michael Jackson and some of the Doobie Brothers and Michael McDonald stuff. I always liked that vibe. David Foster.
Oh, yeah.
The I Am Earth, Wind & Fire album was fantastic. Did he?
Is that Rod Temple?
It might be Rod Temple. Yeah, but anyway, that crowd of guys and girls are all good. There's tons, but I can't. Yeah. I'm suddenly sort of my mind's gone blank. Not had a lot of sleep, Tony. Sorry, Paul.
I think
you're right, though. It's about
the genre you choose. Genre, yeah. And because I love Billy Joel, and because he taught me through his music. Just don't be afraid. Don't be pigeonholed. You don't have to write the same type of song every time. So I don't, which is why my album, A Seat at My Table, was called A Seat at My Table. And all the mess on top of the piano was meant to signify I'm made up of a lot of different influences, a lot of different things. And it's all going to come out in my music. One minute I'm going to do Got the Bug Back. The next minute I'm playing country with Albert Lee. So, and I'm never, ever, because I'm not barking up the number one charts, Radio 2, playlist tree anymore. I'm just going to do music that I absolutely love and feel. So I suppose that it depends what I decide to do. Maybe I would imagine I'd go, Benny, if I had a chance, Benny, would you come and produce these two tracks for me? And maybe I'd go, you know, I don't know, someone else, would you come and do these two, because these are really up your street. But yeah, good question, Paul.
Very nice. All right, let me go back to the comments. I believe Carl had a question in the comments. Song you're most looking forward to playing on this album tour. That's from the one and only Carl Wooden.
Hello, Carl.
Hey, Carl.
Carl, I'm so proud to say he's such a great supporter of our music, and he's flying over from Philadelphia sometime in the next day or two. He's going to be there at the opening night in Eastleigh. Thank you so much for that, Carl. Can't wait to see you. And
please give Carl the wrong venue. Like, let him show up the wrong place. That would be fantastic.
You and Carl have this thing, but I know you love the guy.
I love the guy dearly. Absolutely. Yeah, we go to baseball games together. Yeah, I love Carl.
He's a dude.
And I love picking on him, yes.
Carl, that's a really... Again, you must answer this question. If I have to be pressed right now, there are so many songs. Okay, so Great Suburban Showdown, the ones I've not done before, Weekend Song with the band, with this band, Last of the Big Time Spenders, Rosalinda's Eyes, Stiletto, oh come on,
Zanzibar,
and you know, even Los Angelinos.
Yeah, that's...
but the one that we've already mentioned, it, the one that I can't wait to get to is Until the Night.
Yeah.
And Neil and I, so we're going to do what Billy Joel did in 1982 at the Long Island gig. Am I right in thinking you were there, Tony, for that Nassau Coliseum?
No. David Clark was there.
He's too young.
But David Clark was there. David, he was there. So Billy did Until the Night. On the record, it's a duet. He did duets with himself. But live in concert back in those days, he would do it as a trio. And he'd have Doug Stegmaier singing the chorus, this guy here. And he'd have Russell Javers singing the verse. So we're going to do the same. We're going to get Matt Newton to sing the verse. And Neil and I are going to do the Until the Night section.
That's so cool.
I am very, very excited about that.
Yeah, I bet.
There's certain flagship moments, aren't there, in albums that everyone likes. And Until the Night is... I think we're all slightly wary of how we're going to be emotionally as well, to be honest, because it all hits us in different ways,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, I mean, I've always loved 52nd Street, and
yeah. Well, the first time I ever met Neil, was in 1993. He said he would come and play on a demo of mine of a song called "Holding You," which I've still to release properly. But he came down with his fretless bass and he played bass on this demo. I picked him up from King's Cross. We drove to the studio. We said hello to each other. We got to know each other. His sister had been talking about him for years because I'd gone to school with his sister Sue to college at Leeds. And I remember the very first thing that I remember, because I would talk about Billy. He was talking about Freddie Mercury and Queen. This was his thing. Billy was my thing. And I couldn't reciprocate in the way. The thing that I realized that, oh my, this guy really knows his music, is that he went, Billy Joel, 52nd Street, that's an amazing album, Big Shot, Big Shot. And he started to mime it and playing the bass like he does, Big Shot.
And I'm miming on the show as well.
So I remember thinking, oh my God, this guy, you know, he hasn't said, oh, Billy's my favorite. It's obviously that Queen's his favorite, but he knows Big Shot and 52nd Street. So to play this with you.
Yeah, it's going to be amazing.
You know, finally, it's amazing.
But it, the Street Life Serenade, you know, there's some great tracks on that. And of course, when we started doing this, you started to do, you know, naturally you do a deep dive into all the Billy stuff, because there's going to be some tracks that, if you're not an uber fan, you don't know as much. Although he's one of those artists, I think, like Queen, you know, and ABBA and stuff, is that they've done so many tracks that actually you do know, you know, you didn't realize that you knew so much,
right,
you know.
Yeah.
Not just the hits, you know, even some what would be seen as deep cuts, you know.
Yeah.
And I think what's good about this one is that it shows two distinct, like you said about Glass Houses and Innocent Man, they were just, you know, there was only one album in between those two.
Yeah.
So really three years apart.
Yeah.
And this is like 4 years apart, and a lot has gone on, you know. So Street Life Serenade is certainly part of his early.
Yeah, well, it was before he got his band together. He's still being produced by Michael Stewart, who Columbia Records had organized for him, you know. So this is Billy still finding his feet. Yeah. Favorite song, though? Come on, favorites. Which one are you looking
forward
to?
Well, I always like Los Angelinos.
Okay.
But I do like, I love Great Suburban Showdown. Are you talking about that album?
No, I'm talking about what song on this tour? Carl wants to know.
I'm looking forward to Zanzibar.
Yeah, I knew Carl, you'd say that.
And I'm looking forward.
It's the jazzer in him.
I think that's a, it's to me, it's like he'd been listening to Asia, Steely Dan.
Yeah.
You know, Strangers come out, and so has Asia.
Right.
Has gone, oh, this is good. And you can, there's just little, you know, it's Billy Joel, but you know, if you heard Donald Fagen singing, you know,
the audience. Yep.
You'd be going, oh yeah, you know. That's sort of going.
Well, I'll mention quickly. I just mentioned this to Elio just a few weeks ago. Billy Joel coming from Hicksville. Steely Dan original guitar player Denny Diaz, another Hicksville graduate, same year as a matter of fact.
Same year as Billy. They must be mates. They must have watched each other's. Yes.
I don't know. They've never. No. I've never seen anything where they mention each other. If, you know what? I'm friends with Denny and his wife. I'll ask them.
Ask him.
Yeah.
I'd be fascinated.
Yeah.
To
they've
know.
Never. I've never had a conversation with them about Billy Joel. I'll have to.
You must tell Denny, Tony, that he's partially responsible for me naming my eldest son Denny.
Oh, I will. I'm going to write that down.
Yeah. Him and Denny Lane.
Denny.
Denny Lane Denny from Lane Wings?
From Wings, yeah.
I like that name. It's kind of like a good child's name, but it's a good adult name as well. You know, I like it. So
it's nice.
And to my surprise, Davina was like, yeah, that's good. It's like, we like it. So we went with that.
Elio, how are you going to...
Everyone says Dennis, and you go, no, it's Denny.
Denny, yeah. How are you going to feel, Elio, when you're going into something like Until the Night, and then there's Neil playing I Want to Break Free? I mean, what's going to happen there? What are you going to do?
We'll just morph into it. It'll be fine. You know,
he keeps trying to push the Queen agenda in this. Now, maybe if we segued out of Zanzibar.
Until the Night at the Opera.
You see what I mean?
That's what we're going to go with, I think. Sneak it in.
Right in the middle of Until the Night. I'm just a poor boy, nobody loves me. Perfect.
Write this down.
Wasn't there one time when I did my line, which I do honestly and sincerely, I believe Billy's the greatest singer-songwriter of all time. And I think, I can't remember what it was, you were on stage, and I said something. I said, yes, even more than Freddie. And I looked over at you, and Neil just turned his... he turned his bass up, and then he walked forward to the front of the stage and went... Dum 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 dum.
And I hope I'm not getting in trouble by saying this, but one of the times we went to see Queen with Neil on bass, and they're doing the band introductions. Neil comes out, he waves as he gets introduced, and as he's walking back, he does his little you know fake trip thing. laughed my ass off in the audience.
I thought Tony will like this. It's like a trip Tourette's that I've got. I can't help myself. I don't know why it is.
I've actually had words with him about it.
I don't do it on the Billy Joel songbook.
If you worked with me, Neil, I'd be asking you to do it more. That's just my humor.
You know, you've put it back into his mind now. You know that, right?
Woohoo!
No, don't worry.
All right, no, Elio.
I've not done it for a while. Well, the pandemic, for starters.
Well, true, yeah. All right, Elio, if Billy Joel agreed to come on stage and do one song with you, what song would it be?
Ooh. I'm going to say You May Be Right.
Really?
Two pianos rocking out, extended piano solos in the middle.
Wow.
Nice lines, nice harmonies together. Again, you've put me on the spot, but the first thing that comes to my mind is that would be a great show stopper moment. It's a great song.
Big Man on Mulberry Street.
Yeah. Big Man on Mulberry Street.
You could answer each other's phrases.
Oh, that's a great idea as well.
Baby Grand. You singing Ray Charles' part.
Baby Grand. Well, yeah, there's an obvious answer. And yeah. But of course, this is never going to happen, so I don't really have to worry about it.
Never say never. Never say never. I don't like the negative attitude, Mr. Pace.
Say that again, Tony.
I don't like the negative attitude.
No, it's not negative. I'm just happy where I am. I'm happy. I've got Neil Fairclough singing harmony with me on Until the Night. I couldn't be happier, you know.
Ed Thornton wants to know, what three non-Billy Joel songs do you wish Billy had written so you can include them in your shows?
That is fantastic. Ed, that's got to win the question of the night, definitely. The first song that's just popped into my head. So basically, you're asking me what are my top favorite three songs, really. Yeah. Wichita Lineman would be one.
Love that song.
I just think, and I actually think, am I wrong? Tony, correct me. Has Billy said that that's the song he wishes he'd written?
That's one of the songs he has said he wished he'd written. I can't say it, but that's what he said.
That's right. So I would say Wichita Lineman, definitely. Three songs. Help me out, Neil.
Excuse me. I'm sorry, I keep...
You haven't got COVID, have you?
No.
I hope not. I hope not, mate. Please.
Would one of the three be Born to Run?
Definitely not. And that's a leading comment.
I had to say it.
He knows. Well, if you want to go there, I just... don't happen to be a big Bruce Springsteen fan.
That's cool. He's wrong.
I think he is a lovely, lovely man. I love his stage presence. I love his persona. I love the way he comes across. I love him in interviews. Yeah. I love it. When he's interviewed about rock and roll, it's just awesome. He talks about whether it was Jerry Lee Lewis or whether he's talking about... I just love that guy. I love him. The music just doesn't touch me. That's
what about
it is.
Idol? Elton John.
Let's choose an Elton John song that I wish I could do in the show, and it wouldn't be that one. It would be Little Genie.
Ooh.
Whoa, Little Genie. You got so much love.
Was it Mark who asked this question?
It was Ed.
That was Ed Thornton.
Ed Thornton now is shaking his head going, I disagree.
He probably does. I think Little Genie.
I think he's with me, Idol.
Idol's great. Come on in.
It's one of my favorite Elton songs.
Louis was a light star.
Yeah.
Do you know it, Tony?
I do. I couldn't tell you the last time I heard it, to be honest with you, but I do know it, yeah.
It's from the Blue Moves album. It's a work of art by Elton John.
It's got the Brecker Brothers and Dave Sanborn on it.
That's right.
Yeah. Really? Oh, really? Wow.
I think, yeah, that's right.
Well, it's got Sanborn, definitely.
I mean, Elton John wrote some great songs. So I'm going to say Wichita Lineman, Little Genie, and then a song that I don't think Billy would have written, but one of my favorite songs I absolutely love. Well, there's a Neil Diamond song called And the Grass Won't Pay No Mind. There's Funny How Time Slips Away by Willie Nelson. And there's a song that was written by an English guy for Elvis Presley, actually. The song is called Wonderful World. It's written by two guys, Doug Flett and Guy Fletcher. And they, two English guys who wrote this wonderful song that was for an Elvis movie, but I think it's one of the most beautiful songs. So, so yeah, there's your answers.
Who's Guy Fletcher? What else is he known for? I know that name, but I can't place it.
Well, Guy Fletcher, he was a singer-songwriter in his own right. I don't think he had much success on his own in the early 70s.
He must have.
But he wrote.
Yeah, he
must have
backed
somebody.
Yeah.
Yeah, really?
He must have backed somebody up or something that I like or something. So I definitely know that name.
He wrote another song for Elvis, which is a killer song called "Just Pretend." If anybody knows that one. But Guy Fletcher's son is a superstar in Britain. His name is Justin Fletcher, and Marcella will know him because he's Mr. Tumble. So
is he Mr. Tumble?
Yeah. The guy who's Mr. Tumble is the son of a fantastic songwriter called Guy Fletcher. So there you go. There's my answers.
Harvey Williamson wants to know if... What?
Oh. Hi, Harvey.
Hi, Harvey. Okay.
He wants to know if you'll be performing the lost verse on the song The Entertainer, which, you know what, my apology. I was supposed to send a copy of that to you over the weekend. I forgot, but I'll get that
that's
to you.
Okay. Harvey, that's... I love questions... by Billy Joel fans that know what they're talking about as well. I don't think you know this, but well, Tony could probably describe it more because you know it better than I do. But Billy wrote how many, one or two other verses for The Entertainer?
I think it's just one, but I'm not positive.
Which one? Which he used to perform live, right? He used to perform it live, but he didn't record it for the Street Life Serenade album. So Harvey, I would say that seeing as it's you, and Harvey's been an amazing support of my music, he does what you do, Tony, in Britain. He works for Lim Radio. He's a presenter on Lim Radio. He worked for the BBC for many years, and he's a fantastic broadcaster and features my music. He's played Deccan Traps over and over again.
Nice. Thank you, Harvey.
Yeah, we love Harvey. So, Harvey, I'll tell you what I'll do. I will find that verse, and I will perform it for you in Lichfield because I believe you're coming to Lichfield.
Nice.
You don't get people doing that every day, do you?
That's right. It's always special at an Elio Pace concert. That's for sure. All right, I got to get to some Emma Lumley questions.
Okay.
She has submitted between the last Q&A and this one, it's got to be around, I don't know, 5 million questions.
Before we do that,
sure.
You got to say hello to Amy. Amy's here.
I wanted to say hello to Amy. We were under strict instructions not to. All right, there she is.
Ah, hello.
Hello, lovely.
Good evening, Tony. How are you doing?
We're all here.
Do you know what's brilliant, Tony, is that Amy has been back and forth. It's just she's been brilliant. It's like special forces crawling along under here.
I've just been keeping a low profile so I didn't disturb the boys in that special
interview. What were you crawling for? Were you serving them more dessert? What's going on there?
No, I just made sure I wasn't spoiling the beautiful view you have.
No, it's got even better, hasn't
it? I was going to say, now it's a beautiful view. Before, not so much. Two bald men and another man with a hat.
Three bald men.
There you go. So how are you, Amy?
I'm very well, thank you, Tony. How are you doing?
Doing all right. Now, you just finished up a nice run at, I don't remember the name of the theatre, but...
Yeah, it's called Chipping Norton in the Cotswolds. It's a lovely area, Oxfordshire, in England. And I did pantomime. I was playing a baddie in pantomime. This is our traditional show we have at Christmas time in Britain. And we had an absolutely fantastic time.
That's fantastic.
Amy played the baddie of the piece. She was the wicked witch, the wicked evil stepmother of Rapunzel. That was her character.
And this is a little model. This was a last evening present.
I was going to say that it does. Whoever made that, it does look like you. I can see you in that.
Yeah, it's based on my costume and everything.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. And what and what's coming up next? Anything good?
Who knows? There's just lots of self tapes, and we're gonna see. But I'm writing. I'm gonna write a little radio show for the Queen's Platinum Jubilee.
That's right.
I'm gonna present a little radio show on Lim Radio. And yeah, so I'm researching that and doing various bits of writing, and I've been researching the history of rock and roll, actually, because I want to do a show and sing the songs from the history of rock and roll with the lady voice.
And right, you watch The Kids Are All Right and some of the Beatles anthology, right?
Oh yes. Yeah, I've been watching it all. It's amazing. Good stuff. I'm really passionate about it.
I'm now stopping Amy and going, Amy, can I just ask you something? Because Amy has like got all this history of rock and roll fresh in her mind. She's nice. A bit like, she's like my Google go-to at the moment, you know.
Any particular bands in particular that are you know, that you're getting more information on, or it's just broad rock and roll?
Yeah, quite broad. I mean, I've watched quite a lot of stuff about the Beatles because there's so much of that.
Yeah.
But just, yeah, also, it's a 10-hour documentary, isn't it? The one, what's it actually called, Rock and Roll?
The History of Rock and Roll.
The History of Rock and Roll. And so many incredible people being interviewed on there. And it's just, I just try and, you know, remember all the quotes and the things that really stick out in your head. It's incredible. It just traces change throughout history. It's always contained in the music.
And the point of this is that Amy's planning on putting together a show where she sings male songs only, songs that were made famous by male singers. So tell Chuck Berry.
Chuck Berry and Ray Charles and the Beatles and, and the Eagles, all of them. I'm just going for
You're doing
it.
Some Billy Joel, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, yeah, I think I'm going to get a bit of Billy Joel in there as well. Of course. How could I not?
Somebody's going to be very jealous, I think.
Bring it on. The more Billy Joel that fills the world, the better it is. Certainly after what Neil was talking about. Yeah.
That's fantastic. So did you say Huddersfield? Was that the name of the town?
Chipping Norton.
Oh, Chipping Norton. Norton. Oh, because we got a comment here from Don, who says Huddersfield Town in the house. I don't know what that means. Is that Neil, is that where you're
Huddersfield?
It's a Yorkshire man.
Yeah.
Or lady. Who is it? Sorry?
His name is Don. He actually does a show here, but I know he has family in England, so I guess that's what he's referring to.
Yeah.
Hi, Don.
Well, yeah. My dad's from Yorkshire. Come on, Huddersfield.
I'm from Lancashire, but we won't hold that against each other, will we?
No.
Oh, that's rival towns, is it?
War of the Roses, mate. Is it War of the Roses?
It is, yeah. The counties. White Rose, counties. And the Red Rose, counties, yeah.
Elio's going to have to hold you two back.
That's right.
All right. So I'm going to get to some Emma Lumley questions.
Yeah, we love Emma. Thank you, Emma.
Yeah, hi, Emma.
Thanks, Emma.
First question. Which artist have you met? In fact, I'll hit all three of you with this one. Oh, where'd she go?
Amy, come.
Okay, right then.
Right,
come on.
Yeah, let's go all three of you.
It's much more fun this way.
Come absolutely. On. Which artist have you met that has left you utterly starstruck?
Well, it's easy for me.
Okay.
Glenn Campbell.
Oh yeah, that was amazing.
And Neil, were you there for that too? Playing with the Wogan show?
I was, Tony, and I've got a story to tell you.
Sure, I'd love to hear it.
So this was Weekend Wogan. Let me set it up for you. It's Weekend Wogan.
I'm not sure if I can get through it. I'm shattered about the whole experience.
It's really funny. He doesn't let this go. He will not let this go. So this is 12 years ago, 2010.
Okay.
And Glenn Campbell turns up on Weekend Wogan on the BBC, and I was the house band. I was the leader of the house band. Neil was in the band.
And we're all like this.
Absolutely. Yeah. It may as well have been Elvis Presley walking through the door, as far as I'm concerned. And there he was. And I didn't get to play for him. I wrote the arrangements for one of the songs for Southern Nights, but he brought his own piano player. But Neil did get to play.
Why didn't you just grab a tambourine or something?
Good question. There you go. I should have done.
Hindsight, Tony, hindsight.
So so we're doing the song. Go on. He won't let this go.
So we're doing Southern Nights, and as we start playing the track, it's obviously something to do with his monitoring and stuff, but, you know, I was thinking, it's Glenn Campbell. It's amazing. I can't believe this. And, of course, the one thing he says is, because it obviously is a bit loud in his ears. He says, which track was it we were doing?
Southern Nights.
He starts singing, and after his first line, he goes, "Turn the bass down." I'm panicking, thinking, "Oh, is it, am I too loud?" But obviously, it's the monitoring, so they've got to deal with it. And then he does another line, and he goes, "Bass down."
Bass down.
By this time, I'm sort of feeling really bad, you know.
Because what Neil's technically thinking is that if I turn my bass down, then that means that it turned down so it's quieter on stage. That's one thing.
Right. But
it's also turning the level going to the desk that is transmitting live to the world. So all of a sudden, I've turned my bass down. It's going to disappear from the mix out there as
right,
well.
Right.
What did you do? What did you do?
I think in the end, they must have sorted it because I pulled it back a bit and then I managed to get it back. He was fine after that, but it was me who wasn't fine.
I can't mention Glen Campbell without Neil telling that story.
No, but it was a brilliant experience. And,
Do you guys have Bugs Bunny? You know, growing up as a kid.
Yeah, of course.
Remember the one where he's the concert pianist, and he's playing the classical thing, and the guy's coughing in the audience, and he's shh. He's playing. The guy coughs again. Shh. Trying to play again. The guy coughs. Bugs pulls out a gun and starts shooting him.
Well, I'm doing a lot of coughing here today, so don't do the same, Tony. Yeah, right. I get 3,000 miles across the ocean.
That'll be some gun, yeah. Amy, how about you? Who left you starstruck?
You can say.
Obviously, these two, obviously. You know what? When it was the 80th birthday celebrations of Jerry Lee Lewis, and you guys were on stage performing with Albert Lee and James Burton, Elvis's guitarist.
Joe Evans on drums.
Yeah, doing a fantastic job.
Hello, Joe.
I love Joe.
I was in the wings taking some photographs and documenting the event.
At the Palladium, right?
Yeah, at the London Palladium, yeah. So I was stood in the wings there and Jerry Lee Lewis was sat right there, just waiting to go on stage with his entourage around him. And there was a real air of, I don't know, magic about him. You couldn't get that close to him. I could just see his shoes. He had these white leather loafers on, and I could just see his little foot tapping as he was waiting to go on. And was he
tapping his foot to us?
Yeah.
Was he enjoying our music?
Yeah, I could see it. Because that's all I could see of his body, so was his little white shoe, and I could see, yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah, I think the whole reverence bit, what was apparent was Ringo was there.
Yeah.
There we go. Ringo was stood next to me.
Ringo.
Sorry, I should say Ringo Starr was stood right next to me.
Yeah,
he
was. Ringo. Yeah. And
it was pretty amazing.
And then Robert Plant, who sat opposite, and I think we'd been introduced and stuff, and Robert said to me, how are the guys? Are they all right? And I was like,
he's talking about Queen.
Queen, yeah.
Roger and Brian and Adam and stuff, and I said, "Oh, they're great," you know. But at this part, I was going, "That's Robert Plant. It's Robert Plant," and he started talking to me. So I was like, "You know, trying to be cool." Yeah,
because right. You are a huge, huge, huge Led Zeppelin fan, aren't you, Neil?
Yeah, yeah.
So that was something.
But but it was lovely. That was great. So yeah, I think moments like that where it was unexpected. Ringo and
Andrew Lloyd Webber was there that night as well.
Was he?
Yeah,
well, that's cool.
It was his theatre, isn't it?
It was his theatre. It was the most unbelievable experience.
He got
Tony.
There late, didn't he?
Midnight.
Sorry.
Can I apologise on behalf of all of us to the whole world for his dad jokes?
Can you tell the Ringo story from that night? You got a good Ringo story from that night.
Me?
Yeah.
Or was it you?
No, you didn't. He didn't refuse to shake your hand, or he smacked
it
or something. Yeah, that's a great Ringo story.
Is it?
I think that's a great Ringo story.
We're both standing side stage in the wings, watching Jerry Lee Lewis performing. So I'm my mate Ringo Starr and I are watching Jerry Lee Lewis from the side of the stage, and he turned round and as I came up and he said, "Oh, hi, you know, enjoyed it," or something like that. And I went, "Thank you very much. It's great to meet you." You know, I went like that. And he literally went, like that on my hand, like that. Just went, cool. Like, yeah.
High five.
Yeah, I went to shake it, and he yeah. went as if I'm not a handshaker. I'm right. a slapper.
Ringo's too cool for that.
Yeah.
So
well, he's you know he's keeping time as a drummer, you know.
Had Ringo Starr's hand. Yeah. Slap your hand.
Yeah. Yeah.
Think about all those records.
I know.
Amazing.
I shook Glenn Campbell's hand, and we spoke for about 3 minutes.
It's funny because I should say, when I did speak to Ringo, he said, turn the bass down.
That was a one-sided conversation, wasn't it, really?
Maybe Ringo had blisters on his fingers. Maybe that's why he couldn't shake hands.
Yes.
Neil, did you get that? I don't know if Elio will get that, but you'll get it.
Blisters on your fingers. That's yes. Yeah, he's a drummer, right? And that's also a lyric from Dire Straits. I don't know which one I'm supposed to...
No, at the end of Helter Skelter, Ringo yells that out.
Oh!
I've got blisters on my fingers!
Sorry. Oh, yes, of course.
And then, if you want to really get nerdy with me, Billy Joel on the extended version of Sometimes a Fantasy, that was a B-side where they don't fade the song out, they just let it play out. Did you ever hear this? At the end of it, Billy yells, I got blisters on my fingers! He's imitating Ringo.
I have heard that. Now I recognise where it's from.
I thought you said Tony knew a lot about Billy.
Yeah, I know. It's embarrassing, isn't it? I wish you'd do your homework. Yeah, and I was going to say, I had 3 minutes with Glenn Campbell and shook his hand. He was tuning his guitar. There was all this other stuff going on. I think his MD was talking to you and talking to Brian, our drummer, and Darren, our guitar player, and just sorting out the rhythm section. And I thought, this is my perfect opportunity to go and say hello as the musical director. I've done the arrangement for this, that, and that, and Rhinestone Cowboy, he didn't do it in the end, or Wichita Lineman, we didn't do in the end because we didn't know at the time why there was this sort of edge of an atmosphere in the room when he arrived. He was supposed to do four songs, and so we did four arrangements for him. When he turned up, he was...
his daughter.
Well, his daughter was there, but they said he was going to do two songs. Mm. And the BBC were like, well, you know, we've planned it and there's this, that, and the other. What we didn't know was that his people were protecting him because he'd only just been diagnosed with Alzheimer's. We didn't know that. Right. We found out a few weeks later. So
she was really looking after him, wasn't she?
She was absolutely, Ashley.
Ashley.
Yeah. Lovely banjo player as well. Yeah. But so I spoke to him. I had a little chat with him about Elvis Presley, you know, because I know that Glenn played on many Elvis Presley records.
Right.
He played on many records full stop, let alone Glenn Campbell records, but he was a top session player.
Oh, yeah, so Beach Boys, to, yeah.
Beach Boys, the Mamas and the Papas.
Frank the Monkees.
The Monkees, Dean Martin, everything. And then, in fact, that's him playing guitar on The Righteous Brothers, You've Lost That Loving Feeling, isn't it? Or something crazy like that. Yeah, and then I spoke to him about Albert Lee, because I know that, in fact, Albert had been offered that tour with Glenn Campbell to play lead guitar, right, and Albert had to turn it down because of other commitments. So I mentioned, you know, and that. So I had my little 3 minutes with Glenn Campbell. It was unforgettable.
Another Emma question. What was the last album you bought?
The last album I bought, I generally buy like two or three at the same time. They are, I'm going to tell you, because I have got them.
Mine was Sting, The Bridge.
Oh, what do you think of that?
You mean that one there?
I like it.
Yeah, I liked it too.
Yeah.
That's one of them, Emma. I bought that. Not my favorite, sorry.
Okay.
Just being honest.
I like it, though. It's kind of getting back to classical Sting.
I love Sting.
Yeah, but you have to say that.
No, I think it's great.
Because he's going to turn up and come and guest with you and Queen at some point, you know. And
you know, you've said a few things and they've actually come true, so keep talking.
Yeah, I know.
Do you know, the last one I bought actually would have been Sting's version of him singing the songs of The Last Ship.
Now that is one of the greatest albums ever.
Yeah.
Singing his own songs.
We saw it in Brooklyn.
Yeah, on Broadway.
Broadway, yeah. When we were in Brooklyn, but we...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We saw that.
Amazing.
ABBA's new album I bought. I bought Willie Nelson's new album. It's called The Family. I bought a couple of Brian Setzer albums. Absolutely love this guy. He's from Long Island, where
Massapequa.
You are right now. Yeah, he's from Massapequa.
He's from Massapequa.
And the other guy I bought, okay, I'm a big Dan Penn fan. So I bought a Dan Penn album. Dan Penn wrote, he wrote some amazing songs, Sweet Inspiration. He wrote Do Right Woman, Do Right Man, or Do Right Man, Do Right Woman, what it's called. He was part of the Muscle Shoals band. And the other person I've...
You are.
You okay there?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The other person I've sort of discovered recently in, I mean, you know, talk about coming to it late, is Gordon Lightfoot.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely love Gordon Lightfoot. So, wow. Yeah. So I've, yeah. So from Gordon Lightfoot to Brian Setzer.
I've not been buying as much because I'm back into my vinyl.
Well, the question was album. What was the last album you bought?
I'm starting to buy new vinyl.
So what's the last album?
Yeah, what's the last vinyl you bought?
Oh, gosh. Actually, it was a present. I think it was the Mute Gods, a friend of mine, a great bass player called Ollie Collins. He, for my 50th, 40th, for my 50th, he got me this album, yeah, and I hadn't been, because my turntable was out of action, so now it's back in action. Yeah, so is that, I can't remember, but there were loads of...
What was the album?
They're called The Mute Gods. It's Nick Beggs and some other guys I've completely forgotten. Sorry about that. I literally the other day I put side one on. I was thinking, yeah, this is great. So I just need to listen to the rest of it. It's a double album, two tracks per side. So it sounds great.
Wow.
What it is, guys and girls, is that at my record player, I managed to get some Wharfdale Diamonds for £20. Two speakers. And it sounds amazing. I'm not a nerd in any way. I really don't know technically what I just know that they're supposed to be good. A friend of mine directed me there. So because of that, I've been putting a lot of old vinyl on, which I've not heard for a while.
It's brilliant. It's brilliant.
There's something about albums on the record.
Tony's not into it. Surprised at somebody who, because you have about like how many 80,000 CDs collection.
Truth be told, I have around 6,000 CDs. Yes. Right. In my collection. So what am I not into?
You're not into vinyl, are you? You're not into buying records.
I'm not. No. See. I love the sound quality of a CD. I think that's the best sound. Yeah. Sound wise, I think that's the best way to get your music.
But not at the beginning. I mean, they did this whole thing about CD, whatever. And then when you look back, it's terrible. They haven't done anything. They didn't remaster it. They didn't.
Right. It was probably mid to late 90s when they started really truly remastering, and ever since then, any CD that comes out sounds great to me still.
Oh yeah, no. I mean, I still get CDs, of course.
Yeah.
But I think there's something about the sort of what's the word I'm looking for, guys?
Purist.
Yeah, but also the sort of...
ceremony.
The ceremony, thank you, yes.
The ceremony of reading, open, you know, reading the in...
Oh, that I do with this. That's why I love CDs. I love reading the liner notes and the art and the photos, all of it. I love all that stuff.
But the act, you're talking about the act of pulling the thing out, sticking it on, putting the needle on.
Yes, exactly. And then you know, there's no temptation to skip. Although I do skip a lot when I'm listening to vinyl. There's a lot of around the room, but there's something about it that sort of I don't know, it's an enforced but in a nice way, just let it wash over you, you know, and I think, am I making sense?
It does sound, you know, if you have got the right stuff, vinyl does actually sound deeper and warmer and richer than the majority of CDs, I would say.
So, yeah, if you have the right stuff, though, like you, that's key, because I don't think most people have the right, you know, a true vinyl, good vinyl player. But
yeah, no, you're right.
All right, I'm going to do one more Emma question. You're hosting a dinner party and can invite six celebrities. Who would they be and why? P.S. If you invite Elton or Dave Grohl, please invite her too.
Emma's a massive Elton John fan.
So it'd be Emma, Dave Grohl.
Yeah.
Elton John. Right, you do two, I'll do two.
Oh my gosh.
Ladies first.
Oh no, I'm terrible at these questions. I can never come up with...
I've answered this question. Okay, I'll get mine out of the way. I've answered this question before. And I would still answer it the same. I don't know if your American people will know who Stephen Fry is.
I think they will.
Yeah, okay.
Stephen Fry, you and the Americans will definitely know, as well as the British and probably everyone in the world, Ricky Gervais. Those would be my two.
Yeah. Oh. Shall I go next?
Yeah, please do.
One of my heroes is Carl Sagan.
Oh, wow.
He's not around anymore. Unfortunately, he passed in 96.
So he might not make it to dinner if you invite him. He might not make it to dinner if you invite him then.
He might not make it to dinner, but I'm sure he'd find in the quantum realm some way of getting there. You know. But I always find him...
I obviously know who you're talking about. Just for the people who are just, you know,
well,
who don't know.
He did the original, I think Neil deGrasse Tyson did a sort of a reworking of something called Cosmos, which was originally on back in like 1980, and Carl Sagan did it, Human Voyage. And have you not seen Contact with Jodie Foster? I'm on my own here.
Great movie.
I bet Emma has, yes. Right. And it's fantastic.
The only movie Matt McConaughey is good in.
Ooh, oh, well, that's controversial.
Whoa. Time to Kill. And we all know why. Sandra Bullock.
Oh, true.
Actually, isn't it Matthew McConaughey's in The Gentleman that we were talking about on the latest Guy Ritchie film?
Yes, he is. Yeah, he's in that as well.
I really enjoyed him in that.
I like Matthew McConaughey.
Yeah.
Sorry, who did you say was your in awe person that you met? The person that you were starstruck by?
You agreed it was Glenn Kimball.
What about Sandra Bullock?
Oh my gosh, I got to meet Sandra Bullock.
We need to set this up, Tony.
Go ahead.
Neil's got a thing. He's got a thing.
Sorry, Davina. But
she knows all about it.
Yes, exactly. So, since seeing Demolition Man, 1993.
Sting did the soundtrack.
Yes, he did, yes. And then Speed, 1994. I'm not going to go through all the years.
Don't go.
The Net, 1995. No, my little Hollywood crush, amongst others, was Sandra Bullock. And so anyone who knew me would crack up going, oh, is Sandra Bullock in this, you know, blah, blah. And then we did, we played at the LA Forum in 2019. And
Date?
Oh, what was it? July? Can't remember what it was. 20... something. Anyway, and I think one of the producers was working with Sandra, and she came to the show.
Wow.
And I got to meet her before the show, and everyone was basically saying, our bass player's a massive fan. I was pacing the floor.
They can't see that.
Oh, sorry, if you could see me, I'm pacing the floor. So I got to meet her. She was lovely, brilliant. Had a couple of photographs with her. I met her lovely chap as well. And yes.
And she filed the restraining order the next day?
Yeah.
No, she didn't. And she wouldn't have to worry about that because some of these Hollywood stars, as you know, do have weirdos who chase after them. That's not me. But I think I can safely call her Sandy now.
Can I tell my Sandra Bullock story and then we can come back to your two?
This is amazing because he told me this and I was like going, you did what? And yeah. This is like years ago.
This is 1994 or 96. You tell me. She was making In Love and War with Christian O'Connell.
Yes.
You know the film, Tony?
No.
We can go on. Mastermind. Between us, Sandra Bullock.
Maybe Sandra Bullock.
It'd be the longest episode of Mastermind ever, wouldn't it? I was doing a gig. I was days when I used to literally pack my piano into the back of my car, two sets of speakers, a PA head, a microphone stand, and I would drive into central London, set everything up, and do a little piano gig. You know, just a little part, a bar, a pub, a piano bar type of gig. And one of the gigs I was doing was in the King's Road, and I used to do Fridays in this King's Road. The guy that used to do Thursdays calls me up, and actually that's Christian Henson, who has since become one of the most successful film composers in the world. And Christian said to me, he calls me up in the middle of the afternoon on the Thursday, says, Elio, can you do tonight? And can you swap? And I'll do tomorrow night. I said, yeah, I can do that. What's up? He said, well, I don't know, but I've just had a call from the venue saying they want this sort of music and this, and that's not what we do, and that's more like what you do. I think there's a party going on there tonight, and your music would be slightly more suited than their sort of very, very cool acid jazz type of vibe. I said, yeah, I'll do it. Jumped in the car, turned up, and to cut a very long story short, it was Sandra Bullock's team who were filming in London, and Sandra Bullock walks in with Chris O'Donnell and about 20 other people, and they literally sit at this prepared table that had been like sitting there and reserved for about 45 minutes. I did my whole first set to empty tables here. The rest of the restaurant was absolutely packed, but this table reserved. Reserved for who? In comes Sandra Bullock. I mean, I was like, oh my God, she looked gorgeous. It was her 30th birthday. She was having her 30th birthday party in London, and I was the entertainment.
It's a shame I've not got my tea. So I
could do my glasses. You could do your glass trick.
I steamed my glasses up. So it's,
thanks. He breathes into his cup with warm, with
I basically
hot water.
Say, who was that lady? Who's the actress who's in Miss Congeniality? As they say her name, I make my glasses steam up. It's childish.
It's very funny. No, it's funny. It's funny.
So I think it's hilarious, yeah.
And that was, so they got steadily more and more drunk, and I was, you know, turning the volume up a little bit more. The whole restaurant now was singing along and dancing. And then somebody shouted out, get Sandy up, get Sandy up. I was like, okay, Sandra, do you want to get up? And she did. She got up and she came up to, I had a spare microphone. She stood next to me at the piano and she whispered into my ear. She came in and she went, I'm very drunk. And I can't sing. So I said, okay, what do you want? Well, let's do it. What should we do? And I said, should we do Sandy and John Travolta? You know, let's do You're the One. What was it?
Summer Loving.
That's it. I sang Summer Loving with Sandra Bullock. And then Chris O'Donnell wanted to do something. He got up and we sang Brown Eyed Girl together. So that was my Sandra Bullock song. And I've been dining out on that one with you. He gets me to tell it. That's how much he loves Sandra Bullock. Do you just tell your Sandra Bullock story? Tell you one. And now he's got one of his own.
Congratulations.
See, in order for these things to happen, you need to get someone to tell their story of whoever it is that you want to meet, and it will come true.
That's the moral. Right, you've got to choose one other person at dinner, and Amy's got to choose two.
Oh, right.
Carl Sagan.
And do you know, you won't know her over there, but there's a comedian over here called Victoria Wood, who's also deceased, I have to say. I just realised that there's a thread going through my...
Right.
I think it's because of that reason. I think because they're not around, you know. Patrick Moore would have been another one.
Another one?
Yeah. But her name's Victoria Wood. She's not far from where I'm from, up north. And very clever and brilliant writer, comedian, musician... just had her own vibe, didn't she? I bet she'd be entertaining. She seemed like she might be quite shy.
In real life, yeah. But a really interesting lady, very clever.
So very clever.
I went to school in Morecambe. I went to the sixth form in Morecambe. I believe she lived there for a while. And Silverdale, very close to where I grew up as well.
Right, yeah.
What are your two?
I feel like it's all a bit predictable, but I can only be truthful. I think Nelson Mandela is absolutely incredible. And also one of the first people I was ever a massive fan of was Maya Angelou.
Oh, wow.
We studied her poetry in English. And I just was so taken with her. And we watched her performing her poems. And I loved how she would just break into song halfway through speaking. She would just, if she wanted to sing, she'd just sing. And she was just captivating, charismatic, amazing artist, and always had really incredible things to say because she'd been through so much in her own life. I find her really inspiring and helpful. She was always aiming to be helpful to other people.
I think Amy wins that. She had the best answers.
Totally.
I think, Elio, you have a story about Lucy Liu.
Lucy.
So I was just trying to make something else happen. Anyway.
Lucy Liu. Yeah, I agree with you, Tony. I think Amy's definitely. Go on, mate.
All right. So
I like your t-shirt, by the way. Sorry, I really like your t-shirt.
Yeah, groovy, isn't it?
Oh, but nice.
Can you get that, for example, I don't know, merchandise on tour?
It is available at the merchandise store or from eliopace.com.
Well, and speaking of eliopace.com, that's where they can get tickets, right?
All tickets available. Yeah, thanks for showing that. That's the website. That's got one show there sold out, Kendall. It's a lovely little place up there in Kendall. We love playing. That's where Amy was born, actually.
Yeah. Nice.
But yeah, there are a handful of tickets left in some of those, a little bit more on others, but it's really gone very, very well. We're going to have fantastic houses wherever we go. And I'm so grateful to all of you guys that have bought tickets. Thank you. And I promise you, you're in for a great night. These songs on this album are on the albums. We're all buzzing. I'm literally buzzing about tomorrow's rehearsal. We start rehearsals at 10 in the morning. We start rehearsals in 12 and a half hours time.
Nice.
It's great.
And we have to mention too the tour in the fall that has been announced, that is also on sale now.
Well, this makes me I feel so lucky to be able to have this, you know. These are the biggest, I'm just looking at the list here, these are the biggest venues that I have ever played in my own right, doing, and certainly the biggest tour of the Billy Joel Songbook's history. And it's all because the show has been signed up by the great Phil McIntyre promoters, who, unbelievably, are the people that promote Queen and Adam Lambert around the world. And people would go, oh, well, is that a coincidence?
Yeah.
It's unbelievable how that's happened. And but yes, so those tours are amazing. That list of dates there in the autumn, some of the biggest shows, and can't wait to get there. But that's the Songbook show,
right?
Of course, I absolutely love with a passion. Who wouldn't love going out on stage and performing some of the greatest hits ever known to man, and piled one after another, after another, after another, after another. Few album tracks, stories, brilliant band. The audience know every single word. The last 20 minutes is a dance party, is a sing-along fest. It's an absolute honor to be able to put Billy Joel's music across like this to the audiences that we play to.
We've been doing almost 90 minutes here, so I'm going to... I'm gonna throw in a few more quick questions, and then we'll let everybody go. As you prepare for these album shows, do you guys learn more about the albums? Because you must be listening to it, you know, so closely to get all the parts and figure it all out. So do you learn more? Have you heard things you didn't hear before? Have you gained a new appreciation for these albums?
You go first.
Well, I was just going to say that it's actually constant, isn't it? Because we're always in touch with each other, talking about the tracks, you know, and then there's demos, you know,
live tracks,
what version are we going to do of that, things that, you know, when you're listening to things casually, you, of course, you hear it all and it's brilliant, but when you when you start to inspect, you know, look at the detail, you go, it's absolutely brilliant. Like, I mean, this bit here, you know, and the push in there, but he's straight on this bit and blah blah blah. So yes is the answer to that, absolutely.
Yeah.
There's so much information that starts to pour through that you wouldn't normally have maybe noticed when you're just listening through, you know.
We are starting rehearsals tomorrow.
Right.
But we've actually been rehearsing via Zooms and WhatsApps and phone calls for, I reckon, about a month already.
Wow.
We, as a band, have had dozens and dozens and dozens of calls and a quick call from Mikey. Yeah, I just want to check at the end of this song. I notice he's doing, you know, are we doing this or doing you calling up all the, and Matt on the keys and Johnny and Frank. Frank, who's playing percussion, so many percussion instruments on this, is, but appreciation. Street Life Serenade has always been one of my absolute favorite albums by Billy Joel. I've absolutely loved that album since the minute I heard it.
And it's interesting because it's not one of his more popular albums. So I always found that interesting.
I just love the sound of his voice. I love the... It's the last album in which you really hear Billy Joel as an extraordinary piano player. It's absolutely from start to finish full of the most amazing piano playing. And I'm not talking about great solos or great intros. I'm talking about where the song is driven, apart from the entertainer, but even in the entertainer, that when he comes in, you know, in the middle of it, what he's playing is incredible. You don't hear rock stars playing like this. Mm. You hear session musicians playing like this.
And it's the last album, I think, I would talk to you about vocally, you know. To me, it's kind of like young Billy. There's almost like, is it Turnstiles next?
Turnstiles came next.
That is the point where, you know, he starts maturing in some ways, you know, but it's, you can hear it in his voice, you know.
It's there's just something up. So as a fan of this album, I always use this metaphor about Mona Lisa, you know, like some things are just like the Mona Lisa. They don't need to be touched. So these aren't songs. Who asked this question, by the way?
Me.
Oh, it was you. It was you.
Well, Tony. What Tony, a question.
I am. Beautiful. Yeah, no, I used to listen to this album and just love it from afar, because I would just absolutely adore the sound, the songs, the grooves, the style of music that's on it. Los Angelinos, what a groove!
Yeah.
And the Spanish Latino style piano tenths, you know, the octaves and tenths, and there's something gorgeous about it. But I'd never studied it until now. And then when I put those headphones on and I was listening even closer to what the guy is doing, you go, oh my word. I honestly don't think, I know he's known as the piano man, but I don't think that people really understand how great a piano player Billy Joel, he still is actually, but certainly how he was at 25 years old. Add that into the thing. He's 25 years old, playing, singing, writing, arranging. So to play Street Life Serenade on Friday, well, even tomorrow when we start rehearsing, I'm just, oh man, I'm...
You're going to get emotional.
Yeah, I know do. They will. I get very emotional anyway, you know, so yeah, I'm looking forward to it so much.
Yeah, and I love it because you're, you know, you're going to be playing songs that the man himself never played live. You know, he's never played a full album tour, so it's, you're giving Billy Joel fans something they've wanted for a long time. All right, so let's see. Dale Hudson,
Hello, Dale.
If someone, Dale. If a movie was being made about you, who would be playing you?
George Clooney, obviously. Right?
Goes without saying.
You know what I mean? I mean, I paused on that because I was just expecting to jump in with that.
I wasn't thinking straight away, yeah.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so George Clooney, Tony. So some people would say Bob Hoskins. Some people have said in the past Bruce Willis. Is it who people have said
Ricky
I look
Gervais
like?
Could do
Ricky
good.
Gervais could do a good job of me. Who would I want... Who would I want to play me? I'd want Robert De Niro to play me.
Nice.
Wow. Yo.
So you're a gangster? Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, right. Who would you want to play? Who would play you?
What do you say, though? As an actress, you just want to play. You want to play it, don't you?
So you want to play yourself.
There's some great, great actresses out there.
That would play you?
I don't know.
Robert De Niro.
Robert De Niro, that's a great answer. Neil?
My mum, when who's sadly passed now, but when she was younger, she, you know, your mums always see sort of actors and things in the children that no one else sees. My mum used to think that I looked a bit like Kevin Costner. Very good. You didn't laugh.
I'm trying not to.
He's really laughing. In fact, most people that when I tell them this, they go, "Who? You're joking, aren't you?" Anyway, so because of that, I think Kevin Costner.
Probably Elio's turning red.
Yeah. But speaking of actors, and I'm going to say this, I made a post about this.
Oh.
How good is Denzel Washington?
He's very good.
I think he's massively engaging in everything he's in. I don't know why I put that out there. I was just
he could play. He could play. Why have him as player?
Yeah. Well, listen. If he deemed it, me as a worthy subject.
Yeah.
Well, if we can pick anyone, I'll go for Meryl Streep.
Yes.
She's just awesome. She's
she
awesome.
Is brilliant.
Yes.
Everything
Meryl
she does.
Streep. Sigourney Weaver.
Sigourney Weaver is great as well.
Oh, Tony, what about you?
Yeah, how
about,
you,
Tony?
Oh God,
Billy Joel.
Well, yeah, I mean, I do. I get that. I can't tell you how many people have told me I look like Billy Joel. I get it all the time.
Of course you do.
I wish my wallet looked like his. That's my stock. That's my stock response whenever I get that. I did ask one girl years ago. This blonde girl, very pretty girl. I wasn't married at the time. She came up to me and she actually thought I was him, which. I almost laughed at this girl's face, but I did say to her, I said, well, how would you like to be my Christy Brinkley tonight? Just like that, and she took off.
That is fantastic.
That was
a very clever way of saying I'm not, but
right.
Yeah.
All right. another question. Keith O'Connell. This is a very interesting question.
Keith,
do you know Keith?
I know. I've seen Keith pop up on Facebook. I think he's a musician himself.
Oh, okay.
Hi,
is,
Keith.
Is he a Pacer?
I don't know.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
All right. Well, he wants to know if you would ever consider putting a video course together where you show people how to play all the exact piano parts of songs note for note.
Oh, boy. It's not something that immediately is something I have thought about doing. I have, but believe me, Keith, I've often wished that someone had already made all those videos. You know, I just wish Billy would. You know, isn't McCartney doing piano lessons on YouTube at the moment?
Well, Ringo did a masterclass thing.
I think he's releasing
just a couple of months ago.
McCartney's just releasing. Little 3-minute, 4-minute videos of what he did in Lady Madonna and stuff. I think, Billy's got more time. He's got more time. He's semi-retired, isn't he? He's not doing much apart from Madison Square Garden every so often.
Keith, what I'll do is, when Elio's playing the piano tomorrow, I'll sneak up behind him. I'll get some video. I'll get it off.
Well, I take it as a compliment if that's what you are talking about, Keith. I do. But and I have often wished that there were, you know, I mean, what is Billy playing in Street Life Serenade? What is he doing in all sorts of things? You know, I mean, and luckily there are ways of extracting the piano with certain bits of clever software so you can hear bits and pieces. But there is nothing like, you're right, he's right, Keith is right, there's nothing like than having a piano lesson with somebody standing next to you and going, right, let me show you what I play here, what I do that. I've worked all of this stuff out as much as I can possibly do with the tools available to me from my ears to technology to do as much as I can. But maybe I will. Maybe one day if there was if somebody wanted it or if, you know, I'm not, they're not secrets. They're not things I want to keep to myself. You know, if someone feels that it's, of value, but I, to be honest, doing that sort of social media presence is not something that I've got time for quite at the moment. You have to really commit to being a YouTuber. You know what I mean? So yeah.
Hardest song to learn for this tour.
Well, there's one that you started practicing because obviously. I hear Elio practicing a lot, and there's one particular song that you actually started playing, I would say, a year ago. Yeah, because there's a particular bit that is tricky.
It is. It's just the intro for this one. That's Rosalinda's eyes. I don't know if you can hear that. Thank you.
We heard it just fine.
No, that is one of the most, I mean, I can't wait to sing that song, but, and play it with you guys. But Those chords are absolutely, utterly incredible, and it's not something that would have naturally come out of my head, not something that I am versed in. So I had to work that one out, and when I did, it was like a eureka moment. I was like, "Yes, that's it." The left hand, what he's—it's just this—it's the work. It's the work of genius. So I would say the introduction to that was quite tricky, but mate, you know, the root beer rag is not easy. But luckily, we've been playing that for a few years now.
I guess Rosalinda's eyes is great.
But it's coming as a bass player, you know, is there something that's trickier than others?
Let me just think. Well, I mentioned Zanzibar. That's always a great one to play because there's a lot of good bass in that. I mean, Doug Stegmaier's sound, you know, in all these albums, fantastic. I was really, when we were doing The Stranger, you know, I remember saying to Elio, you know, what was the live gig? It was in the 70s, wasn't it? Was it on that tour?
It was the 1982 one at Long Island.
Oh, it was 82.
Was it Long Island?
I think it was earlier than that, but the sound of his bass live, you know, it was just fantastic sound.
Old Grey Whistle Test, maybe?
It might have been, actually. I think it was, you know. So it was pretty soon after the...
And it's not straightforward bass playing, is it?
Yeah, he had a way of, like... Note length is very important, you know what I mean, to make sure that it's like if you were to play Another One Bites the Dust, you've got to, the note length has to be right, otherwise you ruin the whole thing. You can't go bom 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 bom, bom. You know, you've got to go bom bom bom, but you can't do it too tight, but, you know, so all these little details that you have to remember. And Doug Stegmaier, would his note length would be just so, you know, so he'd play. And it's the difference between it sounding right and it sounding right but not quite right. Do you know what I mean? So you have to... Often what I find is the real work, I don't know if you agree with this, but it sort of starts with the rehearsals, because a lot of things start to come up and you go, oh yeah, that's what I need to do there. Or
can I say, I don't want to embarrass him, but Neil, we work with some great players. We have some fantastic bass players. I've had Chris Pearson play for us, the great Dan Francis Owen is another younger dudes than you, right? Yeah. But these are great, great players. Yes, Neil, though, I've known now for over 30 years. No, 30 years, nearly 30 years, right?
I was two when I met him.
29. Neil has always, always been a stickler for note length, for phrasing, for tempo, he was the only bass player that I ever used to hire for gigs who would insist on the charts, even if it was It's Not Unusual or I Don't Care, Mustang Sally, or whatever the song we were playing, you know, Honky Tonk Woman. He wasn't content with me just giving him a chart, because I write all the charts with the bass notes. He wanted to know what the chords were on top. He wanted to know what was happening in the rest of the band whilst he was going dum 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 dum. He wants to know, is that are you playing major sevens, sevens, flat nines? He wanted to know that a level of detail, which is why I think it's safe to say, well, look, Brian May didn't end up hiring Neil because four other people weren't available. He literally went, dude, are you free to come and play with Queen? And there's a reason. There's a reason why Neil has held that job down.
Kind.
I mean it. There's the reason why. And but players like Dan, players like Dan, players like Chris, and all the great bass players. Yeah. They all absolutely love and respect this guy's bass playing, because Neil's playing is very, very special.
And the rhythm as well. The rhythm of Billy Joel's music, because he's a fantastic writer of music.
Yeah.
There's some intricate rhythms. It matters. What they chose to do actually matters.
Yes. Because, you know, it isn't jamming.
Know,
you're right.
No, they know exactly what they're doing. Yeah. And even in Billy's piano playing, he always talks about the piano as a percussive instrument.
Yes, he does.
And he's beating out the rhythm with his voice, with his hands, on top of, you know, the complexities of the bass and the drums. And, it's so beautiful. The more you know it, the more brilliant and beautiful it becomes.
There's another song. You're absolutely right. There's another song on the Street Life Serenade album called Roberta. And what he's doing is so simple. but it's so beautifully orchestrated. He is harmonizing with his own vocal. He's playing the melody in thirds underneath his vocal. And then at one point he's pushing and singing straight, pushing and singing straight. And then he releases that and all lands together on the, oh, it's tough for me. This isn't, it's not, that's what he did in the first verse. And then in the second verse, he did something else. That's what he's arranged and he sticks to it. It's not easy to play Billy Joel's music. It isn't playing. We're not playing Johnny B. Goode. We're not playing rock and roll. We're not jamming out on, you know, there are little moments like that, of course, you know, but
it's got, you know, it's got verses, choruses, bridges, solo section, you know, another, you know, something else that might come in, you know, it's just always interesting, you know, yeah.
No wasted bars.
But the other thing as well is that speaking of Street Life Serenade, that's the last album where he's, or is it Turnstiles? He's got session players, really.
Yeah, no, they're all session players on Street Life Serenade.
Yeah, but you're right. That's the last one, because Turnstiles is where he started using Liberty and Doug and all those guys.
That's
right.
So it's a sort of historic. It's a sort of it's like an end of an era sort of thing in some ways. You know? So,
and you know, Billy Joel purists may go, you know, well. Because what Liberty and Doug and Russell and Richie and David, what they all did for Billy Joel was extraordinary. Starting from Turnstiles, you know, right up until the Stormfront album, which was basically all of their last album, wasn't it?
The Bridge.
A Stormfront, because Liberty's still playing there.
Well, yeah, Liberty's still there for the Bridge. You're right.
Yeah, the Bridge is a band, and right. With Phil Ramone, you're absolutely right. The end of that era. You're right. You are right. Yeah, but so a lot of purists do talk about those as the golden years, and yes, those were the golden years when all the hits happened. But people have forgotten Street Life Serenade, and they've forgotten Pianoman, the album Pianoman, right. The album Cold Spring Harbor. Well, I haven't. I couldn't put it better myself. I haven't. I honestly think, guys, if musicians, if there are musicians listening still, unless they've all fallen asleep, but if you go and listen to Street, get the album mastered as well as you can, find it on CD or vinyl, cassette, whatever you want, stick headphones on, and really listen to what Billy Joel is doing on the whole of the Street Life Serenade album. And please, this is my question to all of you, send me anybody else ever that could do all of it like Billy Joel does on that album. Street Life Serenade is one of the most underrated albums of all time, in my opinion.
Wow.
Last of the Big Time Spenders. He is playing the piano like Richard T on that. His gospel stylings on the piano are it's like he's a session player for himself. It's like he's brought Richard T in to play piano for him. And then he plays, you know, boom, dun, 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 the Mexican Connection. You know, it's like he's brought in, come on, who would have been a big Latino piano player in those days in sessions in the 70s. Just listen to the album, guys. Listen to it.
And Desi Arnaz.
I'm going to bring as much as I can to it over the tour. But the master was Billy, and it's all there for all of you to listen to. So,
right. Well, Keith O'Connell says he thanked us for, he thanked you for answering the question. He said he's in Dublin, but he met you after the Helix gig, and he's going to see you again at the Olympia in August.
So that's right. Keith, I knew that. That's right. You've just rung a bell. Absolutely. I do remember you are a musician, and I really appreciate your support. And thank you. I'm so thrilled that we're going back to Ireland. We're going back to play in Dublin. We had such great times in Ireland, and we haven't been there for 5 years, 6 years, I think.
Oh, wow.
So I think it's there it is. It's the third gig of the tour. We're doing Dublin and Belfast. Can't wait. Thank you very much, Keith, for your support, mate, and good luck to you.
There you go. And then again, rehearsals start tomorrow. The big shows, the big tour starts this Friday. Elio Pace, the albums tour, Street Life Serenade, and 52nd Street. It's going to be fantastic. Looking forward to it. I'm sure everybody is. This was a lot of fun. As always, are we doing this again?
Yes, please. Tony, I just love talking to you full stop. Yeah. You know, just
no, we could always talk for hours.
He's good. He's good, eh? He's good. He's good. He's good. Anything I miss, you're Billy good. Joel, what? You. There it is. Tony, I really thank you very much, mate. I really appreciate the time.
Oh, thank you guys. And it was a nice surprise to have Neil and Amy hanging out with us today. This was a lot of fun.
It was fantastic.
Listen, yep. Given enough time, we'd have had everyone and all the home drain, wouldn't we?
Yeah.
You run out of time.
Yeah, too late.
Come on next time.
All right. So go to eliopace.com, right, for merchandise, for tickets, to buy some of your music. It's all there. And thank you guys. Have a great, I don't know when I'll talk to you next, but hope the rehearsals go well. Hope the show goes well. Neil, don't let them get too, too violent with the band if they're screwing up.
Well, I mean, maybe it'll be a first. Tell you this time. So, Taskmaster, I've still got the marks. Can you see this?
These guys have been preparing like you wouldn't believe. This is, it's such an honor. It's an honor to have musicians that care about the music. This isn't their baby. This is my baby.
Right.
They don't go home and choose to listen to Billy Joel like I do. So for them to have poured their talent and time into this over the last few weeks, and I know they've been on it, and I know that tomorrow, well, we need to rehearse. There'll be things we need to fix, of course, but I trust them. They're fantastic, all of them.
Great team.
I've been fortunate enough to see the Songbook twice. I can attest for what a great band it is and what a great show you guys put on. So I know this is going to be great. I wish I could be there. I'm jealous of Carl and jealous of everybody. But I no doubt it's going to be fantastic. Thank you, Tony. Have a great time, and looking forward to hearing all about the highlights and how everything goes. And I do believe we have another date scheduled for this. So we'll announce that in another week or two. All right.
Okay. Fantastic.
Sounds good.
Thank you to everyone, to everyone that's been watching and listening and all your questions and all your support. Honestly, can't tell you what it means. It's been a tough couple of years for everybody in the arts, and to come back with tours like this and to finally be able to do it. And here we are sitting in a room without masks on, and you know, it's hopefully the turning point for artists everywhere.
And so, going to see your show is a great way to, you know, celebrate getting back out there. So yeah, it's going to be great.
Thank you so much, Tony.
Thank you, guys. It was a lot of fun as always. Thank you.
Cheers.
All
the best. Bye.
As we head out here, you guys mentioned, it's not a Billy tune, but you mentioned Wichita Lineman, so I'm going to play that to lead us out.
Beautiful. Yes.
Thanks, guys.
Beautiful. Cheers, mate.
See you guys later.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
It's Elio's Aperitif. Still on the line. guitar lineman, Elio. His singers and his band, fantastic.